Well, good morning to you, and I join Dr. Weaver in saying what a pleasure it is to be at the EPC General Assembly, but especially at the Mother Church, Word Presbyterian, who always treats us with great hospitality and makes us think, anyway, they're glad that we're here. I'm sure it's kind of like grandparents, you know, you're really glad to see them go, and then you're really glad to see them leave, too. And I'm sure the Word people are going to feel that way. Dr. Bacote, thank you so much for what you had to say. You really did tee it up, as Dr. Weaver said. And I just would say that in terms of the white guy who's doing a talk today, I think nobody better than Dean Weaver to do this. So I feel like I'm a poor substitute for what he would be saying on this topic. But boy, is it ever important to us. You know as well as I do that we're in a period of great conflict, a lot of anger, a lot of irrationality, and now even violence. And it is important for us as Christians to regather ourselves. Dr. Bacote said, we're losing our minds. The Christian mind can't be co-opted by secular political movements. But that's precisely what's happening in our churches. The Christian mind is being co-opted by secular political movements. Now, we know that public fidelity includes a lot more beyond politics. But I think at Dean's encouragement, we are focusing on politics. It certainly is the hottest topic concerning public fidelity, so I'll stick to it too as we talk about politics. But we need to regain our Christian minds as well as our Christian hearts. I was talking to a Presbyterian pastor not too long ago who's facing some of the conflicts in his own church that have now become quite famous. And I said to him, "What are you doing about it?" And he said, "I assigned to our elders, our session, the task of reading How to Think by Dr. Alan Jacobs." We're just learning how to think again and how important it is. And now we see what it means to be remade in the image of God, to be thinking, rational, reasonable, sentient human beings. And Christ restores us to righteousness and to thinking and to reason. And that is what we want to do. Now, of course, we use our reason primarily to study God's Word. And I do want to think with you about some general 30,000-foot questions to begin with. And then what I'd like to do is track as quickly as we can to get into what the Christian's obligations are in a period like this in the realm of secular politics. And what is the role of the church? What are our obligations as churches, which means, of course, church leaders like you? And let me just say, in case you didn't already pick it up from me, I always appreciate the opportunity to be among ruling elders and their spouses, and I just want to thank you again for your service. All of us who are teaching or ruling elders know, if you've lived long enough, that this is one of the more difficult times to be in church leadership. It really is. We're under much more attack than I ever remember. I would summarize our era that we're in now as one that has greater external hostility to the gospel and greater internal weakness in the church. That's not a good combination. And you and I are in the middle of it. I want to commend you for staying in the middle of it. And we read that 40% of evangelical pastors last year considered leaving the ministry. I understand it. I had those thoughts myself. But I just want to say to you, if there ever were a time not to leave your post, this would be the time. This is when leadership is most called for. As Abigail Adams wrote to Thomas Jefferson, I think it was somewhere around 1790, when we were in a mess after the War of Independence, she said, "Great necessities call forth great leaders." And I would say the same is true today. So let's try to think like responsible leaders. Let's first of all look at the biblical, theological, and historical background for what we're talking about. As Presbyterians, especially as Presbyterians, I might say a little proudly, probably there's some sin involved in that pride, but we have a 500-year history of political thought that's built upon 1,500 years before that and 2,000 years before that, and even before Moses. There was much political thought. As Dr. Bacote mentioned, it's just how people get along. How do we organize ourselves? But in particular, the Reformed heritage has a 500-year history of political thought that informs our thinking today in the 21st century American context. Our views are not altogether like the Roman Catholics or like the Lutherans or the Anabaptists. We're distinctive. We're evangelicals, but we're also Reformed. So I'd like to mention, I think it's 7 principles, if I could quickly, just to get an overview of how we as Reformed evangelicals want to think about politics. First of all, it's a creation origin of the state. That is, the state finds its origin in the creation mandate, the cultural mandate. Dr. Bacote mentioned that, Genesis 1:28. And in this sense, we differ from the Lutherans. We're like the Lutherans in this sense that we hold to the two kingdoms. You have the kingdom of man and you have the kingdom of God. And certainly the church is headquarters for the kingdom of God. Political offices may be the headquarters for the kingdom of man. But Luther would have seen the kingdom of man as a result of the fall. That simply we have the kingdom of man that's to do the best they can to bring order out of this chaos, this sinful world. Well, we believe that for sure. But the Calvinist position is, no, the kingdom of man also is implicit in the cultural mandate that we are to have dominion. And that includes, of course, reasoning our way through how we're going to organize as a society. Now, as was mentioned, the fall brings tremendous complications to this. But we see politics and the nations growing out of the cultural mandate. Secondly, we believe in lex rex. This may not seem so important today, but actually it is. The big controversy is it rex lex or lex rex? Is the king the law or is the law the king? And we believe that the law is the king. No human being, not even kings or queens, are above the law. King David was rebuked by the prophet Nathan, because even King David the Great is not above the law of God. And of course, we have some instances in history. You have Bishop Ambrose, who demanded repentance from the Emperor Theodosius, who slaughtered 7,000 innocent people. And Ambrose insisted upon repentance from the emperor. And there was a great debate until finally Theodosius bowed his knee and acknowledged that he had been wrong. You even see the same thing with the Magna Carta, which put restrictions on royalty. And the Magna Carta was in some ways inspired by Stephen Langton, who was the Archbishop of Canterbury. So if we go way back, even before the Reformation, you see that there was the notion, clearly from the scriptures, that the law is king. Now, it was the law of God. In America, we don't quite say that anymore. The Puritans started with that concept that both the church and the state will be under the law of God. We still believe that God is the ruler of both of those realms. But in the American compromise, by the time the Enlightenment had affected us in the late 18th century, we're a combination of evangelical politics and Enlightenment politics. So now it's the consent of the governed. That's Lockean sort of language. And that's what we are as Americans. We're an interesting combination of Locke and Moses. And it's been a negotiation ever since. And part of the battle is to keep the negotiations open so that no one, either the Enlightenment people or the evangelicals, simply take over. At least that was the idea from the beginning. And we'll talk more about that in just a moment. But we see that the law is king, and every single person comes under the law. There are no president should be exempt from the law's demands. Okay, thirdly, we in the Christian tradition, we see a tradition of the separation of church and state. I mean, even Jesus said, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. Give it to him. If he charges taxes, pay. And then render unto God what is God's. Of course, which trumps everything, no pun intended. But here you have a separation of your duties, and you're aware of both realms. I mean, the Westminster Confession of Faith puts it this way in chapter 23, third paragraph. Civil magistrates may not assume to themselves the administration of the word and sacraments, or the power of the keys of the kingdom of heaven, or in the least interfere in matters of faith. So we, going way back in our Reformed tradition, we certainly support that concept. In fact, one German historian said, John Calvin is the virtual founder of America. Because even in Geneva, you find Calvin making these distinctions between civil duties and ecclesiastical duties. I know in Geneva they get merged in some ways, but you have to take him in his own time. But principally, Calvin saw the distinction. I was at lunch one day with my Jewish rabbi friend, and he said, Sandy, I don't believe a lot, most of what you believe. And he was correct about that. But he said, I want to say that I really appreciate Reformed Christianity. I said, you do? What? I would, please tell. And he said, it's the creation of the pluralistic state. He said, I know I owe that to Reformed Christians. And I said, thank you, you're right, you do owe it to us. But that's a Calvinistic concept of separation of church and state. And it allows us to build pluralistic society like we have in America. It allows us to find common ground even with Enlightenment deists. Now, fourthly, the necessity of Christianity for good statecraft. Now, the Christians very well did accommodate the children of the Enlightenment. We evangelicals did find a way to do business with the Unitarians and Universalists and the deists and the secularists. We found a way to do it, and we always will when we're Christians, because we are necessary for good statecraft. We're the ones who lead the way. But note this, even though we were largely influenced by John Locke, who claimed, as a non-evangelical, that his concepts were rooted deeply in the inerrant scriptures, and we certainly were influenced by Montesquieu, who was a Christian. But nonetheless, we found a way to coalesce with the Enlightenment. But John Adams put it this way. He said, the American government is grounded in reason, morality, so far everybody's okay, and the Christian religion. In other words, without the salt and light of these Christians, this whole thing's not going to work. We Christians believe that. Now, I agree with what Dr. Bacote was saying. We need to sing in a lower key, and we need to be reasonable. We need to listen to people, not talk so much. But in our hearts, we know we are the salt and light of this thing. You know, when de Tocqueville visited America, he wrote later, Americans combine the notions of Christianity and of liberty so intimately in their minds that it is impossible to make them conceive the one without the other. The necessity of Christianity is for good statecraft. That means that we Christians don't tolerate, we don't condone lies. If you're on the left, you don't condone the lie that Trump was colluding with the Russians, at least in a provable way, in the elections. If you're a conservative, you don't agree with the lie that the election was false. It's just clearly proven wrong. Any reasonable person should be able to see through both of those things. We have our minds. We haven't lost them. We're Christians. And so we can identify lies on both sides of the political spectrum. And we don't make excuses. We don't make excuses for January the 6th because those people might have voted in our party. We don't make excuses for Portland or Minneapolis and the destruction that was done there because those people are aligned with our party. No. We haven't lost our minds. We're Christians. And we know lies when we hear them. And our existence in the political order is essential for good statecraft. We understand that. Now, fifthly, I think I'm fifthly, aren't I? Okay, thank you. Universal sin requiring separation of powers. So we believe human beings are sinners. Dr. Bacote mentioned that. Yes, we believe in sanctification. But if you don't have sanctification, you still got the sin, and we know that. James Madison put it this way, the truth is that all men having power ought to be distrusted to a certain degree. The Federalist Papers say if men were angels, no government would be necessary. So that's the reason we separate powers, and I'm so grateful to Franklin and Jefferson and the others, who even as non-evangelicals could see the doctrine of sin had some truth to it, and we need a legislative group, we need an executive group, and we need a judicial group. We need certain state powers, and we need certain federal powers. And certainly the people as a whole need to have certain powers of election. So we're all checking each other. And that's the reason that we Presbyterians have a plurality of elders. We love you teaching elders, but we really don't trust you that much because we believe in the doctrine of sin. It's part of our political heritage that it makes us very suspicious of monarchies in the political realm, and it makes us suspicious of monarchies and bishoprics on the ecclesiastical end. Now, sixthly, individual rights and freedoms. Alvin Schmidt wrote a book entitled How Christianity Changed the World, and he said this: the high value that Christianity from its inception placed on the individual person was in stark contrast to the Greco-Roman culture in which the individual was always subordinate to the state. True liberty, he said, individual right and respect for human personality found no place in Greece or in Rome. We need to remember this, that it is the gospel that believes in the corporate salvation of God's people, but individual salvation as we are justified by individual faith, not implicit faith in the church, but explicit faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as individuals. So that changes everything politically. That we need to be persuading individual minds to take individual votes, and we need to grant individual freedoms equally to everybody in the country. So although we got a bad start in some ways with the Constitution and the great American sin of condoning slavery in the very beginnings of our country, the basic principles upon which these men were thinking actually caused the virtual self-implosion of slavery, in my opinion, even though we lost hundreds of thousands of lives to prove it. Then, seventhly maybe, the necessity of an educated citizenry. Let me just ask here, how many of you took a civics class in high school? Oh, good for you. How many took a political science course in college? Okay, pretty good. Not bad. I wish that you represented the American population. Because what seems to me is that we're starving for political scientific knowledge and for civics knowledge. It would seem very odd to the founders of this country if we Presbyterians were to have any doubts about our obligations to engage in the political realm. I think you can see that this entire American experiment was founded upon some biblical principles. We merged it with Enlightenment principles, that's true. But biblical principles have gotten us where we are, and these men and women put their lives on the line to establish such a political entity. They would be very curious at any doubt in our mind that we should be involved. So let's talk now about the obligations of individuals, Christian individuals, and of churches. Let's look first of all at the Christians' obligations. I want to mention five of them. First of all, let's learn what the Bible says. We've been talking about what the Bible says, but let's be sure that our people know what the Bible says. And I'd like to mention at least six biblical truths that I think we need to be teaching as elders in our Sunday schools, teaching elders in our pulpits from time to time, or certainly when things are controversial, settings like this where we're going to have Q&A is the place to do it, because I just find that when you're dealing with something controversial, you need to get into a dialogical environment rather than a monological one. I mean, you know I believe in preaching. I love preaching. My life's been changed by the preaching of the gospel, and I'm grateful for it. But it's monological. We need to be in the Sunday school classes or Wednesday night settings where we can have give and take on these things to teach on the controversial elements of what we're going to say. And here we're in such an environment, for which I'm grateful, and I look forward to your comments. First of all, we need to teach what the Bible says on Christians' obligation to be engaged in civil politics. I was very blessed by James Davison Hunter's book several years ago, To Change the World. There are so many excellent concepts in that book, which is really three books. But I would I think, differ with one of the major concepts that he mentions of what he calls faithful presence. I do agree that we, as salt and light, we make a difference when we're just faithfully present. But I'd just rather use the words faithful engagement, if you don't mind. Maybe it's a difference between the Benedict option and the Augustinian option. But I would love to see us be faithfully engaged, not just present, but thoughtfully engaged in everything around us. Dr. Bacote mentioned the issue of race. How could you not be engaged? Not just sit there and think nice thoughts. Not just be a non-racist yourself. But as Christians, how can we not be faithfully engaged in this? And by the way, let me say, Dr. Bacote, you are an example of how I think we've got to think in this sense. He's a fan of Abraham Kuyper. Some of you are too. I'm probably a bigger fan of Herman Bavinck, who is his disciple. But nonetheless, if you've read about Dr. Kuyper, you know there's no other way to say he was a racist. And here, Dr. Bacote is saying, okay, he had the original sin. But I'm not going to cancel everything about the man. And the same way with our founders, the first 12 presidents of the United States, 10 of them were slaveholders. That's shameful. But I'm not going to cancel everything else they said about how to put a government together. And I think this is the way we've got to think. I think Dr. Bacote has shown us how to do that. You condemn what needs to be condemned, but you don't just make an asterisk out of someone, especially a brilliant person like Abraham Kuyper. You learn from him what you can learn. And you sit at his feet while you disagree with some other things about him. Some of you may be offended by Dr. King's foibles and sins. Some of them were serious sins. Well, I condemn those sins, but I don't condemn him. And I've been at his feet ever since I've known of him, since I was a child. And I will continue to learn from him. And that's the way Christians need to be. We need to think. So we're obligated to be engaged, to be engaged with people who are Christians and be engaged with people who are not Christians. We are salt and light, and we are neighbors. And Paul said, so then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Okay, especially the church. But to everybody as well, especially to your family, but to everybody who is your neighbor. Okay, so we are to be engaged. And as Calvinists, we have a great tradition. Nicholas Walterstorff puts it this way. He says, the saints are responsible for the structure of the social world in which they find themselves. That structure is not simply part of the order of nature. To the contrary, it is the result of human decision, and by concerted effort, it can be altered. Indeed, it should be altered. For it is a fallen structure in need of reform. Let me stop right there. You see the difference between a Calvinist position and an Anabaptist position, which simply says politics is dirty, and I belong to the kingdom of God, and I'm just going to submit to the government, and I'll accept whatever comes my way. Walterstorff says, no, that's never the way Calvin was thinking. You're salt and light. And when you have opportunity, as was mentioned earlier, especially as Americans, you've got a great opportunity. Things need to be changed and should be changed. And that's part of the Reformed heritage, that we're Reformed and always reforming. Not just in the church, we reform everything. Now, we have no illusions about this world. We'll get to that in a moment. Walterstorff goes on to say, the responsibility of the saints to struggle for the reform of the social order in which they find themselves is one facet of the discipleship to which their Lord Jesus Christ has called them. It is not in addition to their religion. It is there among the very notions of Christian spirituality. If you go back to the Revolution, 1776, Prime Minister Horace Walpole before the Parliament says, gentlemen, let me tell you what happened to America. Cousin America has run off with a Presbyterian parson. He meant John Witherspoon. Witherspoon was leading the way. He signed the documents. So we're neither laissez-faire pietists, nor are we coercive moral imposers of our view. We're salt and light. Now, secondly, from the Bible, we need to learn or teach on the state's moral responsibility before God. There's some confusion here. You know, most of the Old Testament restrictions for the nation have to do with Israel, and you say, well, that was the church. That's the way the church is supposed to behave. It doesn't have to do with the state. Well, that's true in most instances, but it's not true in every instance. You remember that Daniel coaches good old Nebuchadnezzar about his obligations for righteousness among the people. You remember that Ezekiel says the problem with Sodom and Gomorrah, he doesn't say it was a sex problem. He says you didn't take care of the poor. That's amazing. So God is judging secular nations for their lack of righteousness and their carelessness for the vulnerable people. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a disgrace to any people. So we need to teach our people that God actually does care about the nations, and he does judge them, and it makes a difference. And neighbor love means that we help them conform to what pleases the Lord. Thirdly, we need to teach on Christians' obligation to submit to governing authorities. I think we're pretty good at that in evangelical circles. At least we know we're supposed to. I'm not sure we always do. And there are moments of civil disobedience, and Moses and Daniel and Peter and Martin Luther and John Calvin showed us that. Certainly there are moments when we do disobey the authorities because we're obeying the Lord. But I remember in 1988 when Billy Graham went to the Soviet Union, and we were all so excited about it. And what did he do when he got there? He said, you need to be submitting to the government. And all the evangelicals back home said, come on, Dr. Graham, you can do better than that. Really? So here's a rotten form of government, and you're to submit to it. That's exactly what Peter told people to do when they were under Nero. So we have a call from on high to be sure that we show no disrespect. I was at a pro-life meeting. It was our pro-life movement in our city. This is years and years ago. And the leaders were really rallying around the concept of pro-life. I'm rallying around it too. And he said, there are times we need to be civil disobedient. He took a little American flag and he threw it over in the corner of the room. And I left that meeting and I wrote him a letter and said, until there's an apology for that, I am disassociating myself from the pro-life movement in this city. I can't support that. Yes, of course we disagree with the Supreme Court ruling in Roe v. Wade. Of course we do. Any thinking person, of course, would do that who has any sense of God's law. But I'm not throwing the American flag around. That's not only unnecessary, it's immoral, because we submit to the government even when they're wicked, as far as we can in the Lord. Now, fourthly, we teach on the Christian's ultimate heavenly citizenship. This is vital. I noticed that Dr. Bacote said this at the end of his talk. He said, we believe in the resurrection. We believe in the second coming. We have hope. We don't despair. We don't wring our hands. We're not fearful. We're not shrill. The shrillness comes from people who are afraid or who are feeling guilty or some other sinful initiative. So we believe in our ultimate citizenship. I said to the congregation I'm pastoring now on one occasion some months ago, I said, you know what? I think a lot of you have stopped reading your Bibles. And they're a Bible-believing congregation, so they all looked at me like, what's this? I said, you stopped reading your Bibles. And I know you're asking me why I would say something like that. Well, I'll tell you who I think you're listening to. Most of you are listening very carefully to Tucker Carlson. And I'll tell you why. You sound like him. And you're acting like him. You don't sound like Jesus. When you talk about politics, you don't sound like his apostles. You must not be reading their stuff, because they didn't do this. And I think we have to be very, very blunt. To me, the biggest problem in the white evangelical church right now is how they're conducting themselves. And we agreed on our session that we're going to have a no zero tolerance policy. We're going to intervene on every inappropriate engagement from any of our members who are misbehaving It's the how we're doing politics. Not what are your politics, but how are you conducting them? Right now, that's the number one issue. I think Dr. Bacote agrees with me. And it has to do with knowing where our ultimate citizenship is. It's in heaven. We're going somewhere. We're here on passport. This is not our native land. We're passing through. We're serving these people. We love them. They're our neighbors. But we have a home, we have a nation, we have a flag. It's the cross. And that's our identity. And that's the only way in which we bring the nations together. And in history, you'll find that is the only way to bring the nations together in the races. Fifthly, we need to teach on the specific mission of the institutional church. This is probably a little more complicated, but certainly we're to make disciples. And as Dr. Weaver said, we make disciples who are salt and light. That is what disciples do. And they engage in the political realm, the artistic realm, the educational realm, the business realm, and civic life. And furthermore, when Jesus sent his disciples out, Matthew 10, Luke 10, he sent them out to heal and to preach. So there's a big debate now about what the gospel ministry is. It is preaching at the in its first and primary essence. It is to make disciples through the communication of the gospel. But as Richard John Neuhaus said in his book, Freedom for Ministry, it's like it's the prow of the ship. So the proclaimed word is the prow of the ship, but it's not the whole ship. In the holds of the ship, you've got cargo. And when we love our neighbor, we love them in every conceivable way. And if you live in an under-resourced neighborhood, there's no way you can preach the gospel without caring for them, their medical care, and their housing, their food, their clothing, the lousy schools they have, the lack of business investment in their neighborhood. How could you be an evangelist and not notice or care about that? It's impossible for a Christian. So what we speak of with deeds of love and mercy are the entailments, and entailments mean it's necessary. They're entailments of the gospel proclamation. They always go together. If you live in a wealthy neighborhood like I do, people have educational guilds, they have private schools, they have artistic guilds, they have their own doctors and insurance programs. They never ask me about that. I'm not knowledgeable in that. I don't need to be because these people have money. You go to an under-resourced neighborhood, they're going to ask you, pastor, about their education and about their poverty and what we're going to do about it. And you get your gospel back, actually, in working with the poor. So the mission of the church is to love people. And we especially care about their eternal suffering. And that's where the proclamation comes in. We especially care about their eternity. Let's move on. Sixthly, we've got to teach on the global scope of the kingdom. It's an international kingdom. As C.S. Lewis said in his lectures on learning in wartime, he said, "It is a good thing to die for one's country, but it's not a good thing to live for one's country." We have a country. It's Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven. That's our city. And the problem with Christian nationalists who get their own national politics confused with the kingdom of God, it's not that they love their country too much. Lewis says, it's that they love their country too little. Okay, let's talk about the second major area of responsibility. I'm going to have to quit before I finish, which is always a tragedy for the preacher, but everybody else is relieved. The second thing I want to mention about our duties as individuals is to develop solid views on public policy. I'm just going to put up a list of things. This comes largely from Ron Sider, with whom I don't agree on everything, especially his use of Old Testament texts, but in The Scandal of the Evangelical Conscience, he describes how complex public policy is. Well, you start with the Word of God, but there's a much larger grid to go through, and I find evangelicals just stop with number one. There seem in evangelical minds to be no other issues involved. You know, what science says, what history says, whether we can afford this, whether it's popular, whether it's enforceable, whether it benefits the poor. None of those questions seem to occur to evangelicals today, it seems to me. Let's move on. Thirdly, we've got to speak out. And I don't have time to stop on all of these. But we need a whole biblical agenda. That means, yes, we need to be concerned about abortion, about marriage and family issues, about religious freedom, and I'm really concerned about that right now. You Democrats don't do real well on that one. We're concerned about financial indebtedness. Neither of you seem to be doing very well on that one right now. An effective military, constitutional literalism, I'm all for that. But evangelicals are not so good at including care for the poor, stewardship of the environment, public education, where most of our children are going to school. You need to develop a holistic political agenda that represents biblical concerns and use common grace arguments. One time our congressman called me, he said, Reverend, he said, we got this thing coming through the Congress on gay marriage. What would you say to that? Well, good heavens. I said, Congressman, how much time are you going to give me? He said, can you do it in 10 minutes? I said, I'll give it my best shot. This is Harold Ford Jr. You see on Fox News sometimes, Democrat. And we're friends. And I said, Congressman, here's the argument I suggest be made. I said, you know, for the government to recognize a marriage is to give it incentive. That is, to give it a tax break. That's one of the privileges. And I said, taxes are used to incentivize behaviors that are useful for the Commonwealth. And I think if the congressmen and women will study the research that's been done, you'll find that it's in the Commonwealth's interest for people to have a mother and a father, and that it wouldn't make sense for us to incentivize anything but that which is the best way to rear the children of the next generation. Now, you notice I use common grace arguments. He's a believer, actually. I could feed him Bible verses, but I want to feed him things that are useful in working in this pluralistic environment, and evangelicals need to get a whole lot better at this, I think. And then I'll say, start with your own party. You Republicans are great at criticizing the Democrats. And if you're a Democrat and you haven't figured out how you should be criticized, please come talk to me later. I'll give you a list. You Democrats are wonderful at criticizing Republicans. You've got all the points. And some of you Republicans need to be reminded of what your critique is, because it's there. But what you rarely hear is someone saying, you know, my party is failing in this way, in this way, in this way. That's what Christians do. They start with themselves. They examine themselves. And so instead of throwing bricks at the other party, we'll see if Christians really are salt and light, we're going to hear more self-analysis and self-criticism and courage to disagree with your party, like Senator Cornyn is currently doing and receiving a lot of guff for it. And then communicate with your elected officials. Do not dismiss the failures and weaknesses and blind spots. Those of you on the Republican side, the evangelical excuse-making for Donald Trump's immorality has been absolutely atrocious. And I'm not saying you can't vote for Trump. I'm just saying vote for him and hold your nose, please. And no celebrating afterwards, because you have someone who is not representing the Christian character very well. And I'm an independent, by the way, so I'm not attacking you more than others, except for the fact that most evangelical Presbyterians are Republicans. I think that's right. Now, D, vote for people with character, competence, and solid policy positions. You must do all. Luther said, for example, on competence, he'd rather vote for a competent Turk over an incompetent Christian. Now, that's really saying something. I mean, we'd have to know the context of that statement. But it's worth thinking about. Just because someone has all your policy positions, if they have rank immorality in their character, you've got to ask yourself a question. Now, when Trump was elected, for example, now when Biden's elected, I have other things, other criticisms to give, and there are a bunch of them. The Equality Act stinks, and he's all for it. So I criticize him for that. When Trump was president, in a sermon on Sunday morning, I said to you young people, I just want to say something. We all respect and honor and pray for our president, but there are some times in our history when we do not copy their behavior, and this is one of those moments. We're Christians. We don't lose our minds. And then lastly, serve. Volunteer, staff, elected office. It's so important for Christians to get an office. One of our evangelical Presbyterian church elders was a governor recently in my state, Tennessee, Bill Haslam. And Bill's pastor is one of my dear friends, and we're in an accountability group, been in an accountability group for 30 years. So the four of us were invited to the executive mansion for 3 days and just spent the night with the governor and his wife. And so at dinner, you had the governor and his wife and his secretary of state and four pastors across the way. And he had one question that took up 3 hours of conversation. Here was his question. What is a Christian governor? What a great question. It took us 3 hours to answer him. What a great question. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we would all say, what is a Christian citizen? Now, I'm going to stop there because I'm out of time. And during the Q&A, maybe I can talk a little bit about the church's obligations, but we'll stop at that. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you for the institution of the state. You have formed it. And you have raised up civil magistrates. Some of them look like Christians and some of them look like the Antichrist. You've called us to submit to them. You've also called us to be salt and light. And we pray that you'll help us to hold these sacred tensions in their place, that we may be the bold martyrs and witnesses who are willing to stand with Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, in every circumstance, praying in his precious name. Amen.